but from an idea that was already profoundly established in Danker's sketchbook. Although it was somewhat different from the idea we finally made, when Danker's sketchbook had no feet, no shoes on the feet. And the shoes were provided by Siobhan O'Casey, Siobhan O'Casey's daughter, who was a student of Danker's at the Camden Institute evening class. And Danker had been telling Shivy about wanting to make these feet, these teapot with feet on, and how you know, I was getting, well, what shoes do we put on it? And Shivy turned up with these shoes the following week and said, put those shoes on it. So Shivy gave Danker the shoes, Danker gave me the shoes. I modelled the shoes from these shoes that Shivy gave Danker. Although they were, you know, quite different when I finished modelling them. But I think, you know, in fairness, they were different when I finished modelling, not because I'd intended them to be different, but because at that time I wasn't a very good modeller. So they just sort of ended up looking different. But the origins of the walking wear are entirely kind of mystical in some ways. There's quite a genuine Roman walking bowl with feet on. There's a whole Persian or Assyrian culture which may put feet on all its pots. When we made the walking wear in the beginning, it was attributed by everybody to somebody else. Hockley it was attributed to, it was attributed to Lewis Carroll, or one of the Lewis Carroll illustrators. It was attributed to a completely fictitious pre-war walking teapot that never existed. It was attributed to Mary Jane shoes in America, which never existed, well, they existed, but never existed on China.
If you were doing that in America, you'd have your head carved out of the side of a mountain.
I know. Well, I keep expecting, you know, the letter from Buckingham Palace, you know, and I've decided to decline the peerage. You know, I might accept, you know, like a minor, a knighthood or something, but... No, I think, no, exactly right. I mean, and what happened with the English thing, and also there were kind of whole familiar... Well, one of the brilliant things about it was the way it looked like you'd already seen it when you saw it. I mean, there were whole familiarity. We didn't have to break any ground with this. It was a completely radical object that entirely changed, or very part of a very powerful change in the whole English culture. But it also had the familiarity that you felt that you already knew it. So when you first time you saw it, You didn't have to overcome any kind of repulsion, like a lot of avant-garde things, where you have to kind of learn to overcome a sort of revulsion, because it was there. It was charming, sweet. It had all these kind of wonderful, dotty sort of Victorian qualities to it. It had a kind of pre-war, you know, novelty teapot qualities to it. It had historical qualities. And it was very funny. People just loved it. It was like extraordinary. You know, the moment we did it, everybody just adored it, and all our kind of desperate sort of pseudo-political subversive motives, you know, how we were going to, you know, undermine the whole establishment with this thing. It's a pussycat, right? It's going to undermine nothing. People adored it, you know, so we didn't... although there was a moment, I mean, there was about a moment when we could claim some revolutionary zeal from having done it, but mostly people loved it, you know, there's no revolution here. We, in a sense, we returned England back to an Englishness. I mean, if that's highly pompous it's assuming a huge importance which probably doesn't have, but because of the popularity at the time, because of the huge response to it, we did sort of feel that to some extent we gave back, you know, England its Englishness and reclaimed it from the cold, slabby hand of modernist, you know, modulated stuff that, you know, and that Leach could, you know, was interesting, but he could go away now. Thank you very much.
And also made a lot of money. Do you want to talk about that?
Oh, money. Well, yes, money. Well, the problem with money is that it's like water, you know, it flows away. It's kind of, you know, you think, oh, great, I'll set the tap on and I have lots of money, but actually you turn the tap on and you've got this money game. Anyway, money, yeah. Now, so what happened was, it was hugely successful, and we could sell. We had queues at the door, strange ways, to buy the stuff. You know, we used to bring down, we had a studio, we made 30 teapots a week. No, we made 10 teapots a week and 30 cups. And so there was 10 walking tea sets available a week. We used to drive down on Friday so we could get pissed at the weekend with our mates, go back Sunday night and start making for the following week. And we had one assistant, a lovely French girl called Annie Fate, French woman I should say, called Annie Fate, who helped us. So it was the three of us, Dan Camini and Annie, were making the stuff. And Chris could set, I mean, it was sold out. Chris had an order book. I mean, it was just a joke. He used to, people used to come and say, oh, can I have that? And there was about 40 pages at that time, you know, in order to make the walking tea sets, just to complete the orders that Chris had taken, we would have had to work something like 18 months without everyone coming on sale in the general. So Chris and ourselves got together and decided that the handmade values that we cherished so highly, because they were thrown and turned like the 18th century ones, press moulded feet, would have to go by the wall and we'd have to make them. So we found a mould maker in Stoke-on-Trent. I made up the clay models for the moulds, took them to the mould maker, and the mould maker moulded the moulds. His brother had a small slip casting factory, and he made the biscuit for us. We bought the biscuit off him, brought it back to Yorkshire, where Danka decorated it, and we then glazed it.
Was that your way of attempting to control it?
Just increase the production.
Just increase the production, yeah. But at the same time, not lose any sales to, you know, any pirates that are offloading them. Like Stoke-on-Trent isn't exactly a trustworthy place.
No, it's like sort of, you know, putting your head in the crocodile's mouth, isn't it? You know, kind of, you go, yeah.
If there is a you know, a golden goose that they get to hear of up there, they're all onto it fairly quickly, aren't they? Just.
Well, we did take it around a few factories to see whether they would do it. And Alan, I'd done some work for Alan Aldridge on Butterfly Ball, so I knew Anthony Wood at Carltonware. Mm. So when I wrote to Anthony and said, would he be interested, he snapped my hand off. But that wasn't until after we had a kind of a middle course of attempt of having the biscuit made and based it ourselves. So there are some of them with our Luster stamp on, which is a rubber stamp saying Luster Posh.
Oh, yeah.
Which pre-Carltonware production. But what happened is, Chris was selling this stuff, so we increased the production through Carltonware, through our own resources, and gave Chris more to sell, and there was more money coming in, and we got drunker and drunker. Ate more pills. Generally got more. I bought a Morgan. I bought a Morgan car. I bought a yellow Morgan car. Right? It's a wonderful car. And, you know, because one of Chris was friends with a guy called Charles Morgan, who had a Morgan company, so he sold me one.
Okay.
It was really nice of him. I mean, it was just, you know, that money went like that.
Yeah.
You know, the money. So anyway, so we did this, and Roger Horchow, the Horchow Collection, who'd been the marketing director of the well-known Houston department store, the name I completely forget, and the Horchow Collection was a large American mail-order company, and he came over and said, you know, hey, Christopher, we want to buy £20,000 worth of this stuff to ship to America. And I said, what do we do here? You know, do we make it or not? So that's when we went to Carltonware with it. So we went to Carltonware with a £20,000 order from the Horchow Collection and said, you know, here's the order, you know, here's the designs and molds, will you make it and complete the order for us? So they said yes, and they were going to pay us 10% of the value of the order. Maybe even Chris bought it off them and resold them to Roger Horchow. Anyway, we made money out of it somehow. And that alerted Carltonware to exactly the potential in sales that this thing had.